the Philippine Health Department calling for an investigation on the alleged secret campaign of the U.S. military to discredit a COVID-19 vaccine developed by China. A Reuters investigative report exposed the alleged program, saying it was meant to counter China's growing influence in the Philippines, a nation hit hard by the deadly virus. The secret campaign reportedly used social media accounts to sow doubt about the safety and efficacy of vaccines and other aid supplied by Beijing. The DOH now says the report should be investigated and heard by appropriate agencies of the countries involved. China's Sinovac was one of the COVID vaccines made available to the Philippines at the height of the pandemic. The Philippines lauds the strong opposition of the Group of Seven Nations against China's maritime aggression. During their 50th summit in Italy, G7 leaders issued a communique calling out China for its dangerous maneuvers and repeated use of water cannons against Philippine vessels. They also asserted Beijing's expansive claims in the South China Sea has no legal basis. National Security Advisor Eduardo Año says the communique underscores the international community's recognition of the threats faced by the Philippines. He adds Manila will continue to collaborate with the group to ensure peace and stability in the region. The condemnation comes as China implements its new policy authorizing its Coast Guard to detain what they call foreign trespassers in its supposed borders. No Filipino fishermen have been arrested since the rule took effect Saturday. But the Philippines is gearing up for possible worst-case scenarios.
Meron pa yung tinatawag na yan na convention on consular relations. Mm-mm. Yung ating mga konsulado ay dapat harapin kung sino man ang na-detain. Pero kung sinasabi natin, sakop natin yon, hindi dapat konsulado natin ang humarap kasi teritoryo natin yon. So ganun yung dilema natin, medyo mabigat yun yung...
Taiwan's foreign ministry also slams Beijing's rule. It vows to monitor the situation and ensure the safe passage of vessels and personnel passing through Taiwan's waters. The Philippine Coast Guard says China's deployment of amphibious assault ship was meant to disrupt Filipino scientists in Esquadra Shoal. Responding to a report by the Global Times, Commodore Jay Tariella said the Chinese vessel was deployed on June 4 to disrupt the scientific survey of the shoal. He added the rising tensions in the West Philippine Sea is a direct result of China's illegal presence and bullying tactics. Tariella also saying it is not accurate to claim the Philippines is provoking China in any way. Let's now get an update on the weather from Pagasa forecaster Veronica Torres. Good morning, Veronica.
Good morning and to all of our audience at the ENC. Currently, the southwest monsoon is still affecting the western sections of southern Luzon and Visayas. For Palawan and western Visayas, we're expecting cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms due to southwest monsoon. For Metro Manila and the rest of the country, we're expecting partly cloudy to cloudy skies with chances of localized thunderstorms. We don't have any gale warning raised over any parts of the country and we're not monitoring any low pressure area or tropical cyclone near or inside the Philippine area of responsibility. And that's the latest from Pagasa Weather Forecasting Center. Veronica C. Torres reporting.
Thank you very much for that update, Veronica. A two-day summit in Switzerland aimed at forging a path to end the war in Ukraine wraps up with key powers rejecting a joint communique. The document reaffirms a commitment by signatories to refrain from using force to threaten the territorial integrity or political independence of any state. India, Saudi Arabia, South Africa, and the United Arab Emirates all attended the summit but did not sign the joint agreement. Those countries have important trade ties with Russia.
The first and the second peace summits should unite our joint work on the details of peace. We are at a war and we don't have time for prolonged work. Moving to peace means acting fast. Preparations will take months, not years. So when the action plans for peace are ready, and when every step is worked out, the path will be opened for the second peace summit, and thus for ending this war, for a just and lasting peace.
As for the European Union, it vows to continue supporting Ukraine in its quest for lasting peace. But it says the path will require patience and determination.
Our support and this peace summit here brings real peace closer. The goal is a just, comprehensive, and lasting peace. This would finally bring an end to the oppression and suffering of the Ukrainian people. This would reaffirm Ukraine's sovereignty and territorial integrity. And this would restore the primacy of international law and the UN Charter. The path to real peace requires patience and determination. And we have always said, dear Volodymyr, ultimately, it will be for Ukraine to determine the conditions of a just peace.
More than 90 countries, including the Philippines, attended the two-day summit in Switzerland. A follow-up may be scheduled before the U.S. elections in November. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu criticizing his own military's decision to hold daily tactical pauses to facilitate aid delivery into Gaza. Israel's military had announced fighting would be suspended for 11 hours along one of the main roads into the Palestinian enclave. An Israeli official says Netanyahu has made it clear the humanitarian pause was unacceptable to him. The military, however, clarifies normal operations would continue in Rafah, the main focus of their operation in southern Gaza. The spat is the latest in the series of clashes between members of the ruling coalition and the military over the conduct of the war. It comes a week after centrist leader Benny Gantz quit the government, accusing Netanyahu of having no effective strategy in Gaza. Russian special forces freed two prison guards and shot dead six inmates who had taken them hostage at a detention center in the southern city of Rostov. The inmates, who are linked to the Islamic State militant group, knocked out window bars and climbed down several floors by rope before taking the guards hostage with a knife and a fire axe. In negotiations with authorities, they demanded safe passage out of prison. According to Russian media, the hostage takers were from Russia's southern republic of Ingushetia, with some of them convicted of terrorism offenses. A wind-fueled wildfire in California that started on Saturday has now spread to more than 4,500 hectares overnight. The so-called post-fire has prompted evacuations in the Gorman area of Los Angeles. The California Fire Department says only 2% of the fire has been contained. No injuries have been reported so far. China suffering from floods and sweltering heat. China's National Meteorological Center has issued an alert for high temperatures across multiple regions, while many southern provinces issued severe flood warnings. Heavy rains have lashed Fujian province for a week and are expected to continue, with water levels in some rivers exceeding warning levels. Meanwhile, parts of North China and regions between the Yellow and Huaihe rivers are baking under the intensity of high temperatures, but relief is expected in the coming days. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to the friends of the Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region.
We begin in Queens, New York, where 27-year-old Filipino Judd Sanson, who appears to have jihadist views on his social media, was busted on June 12th for carrying an arsenal of deadly weapons in his vehicle. Authorities reportedly apprehended Sanson at a traffic stop in Queens because his license plates were covered.
Our officers stopped the vehicle based on that. They started to conduct an investigation, and pursuant to that investigation, they recover one 9mm Glock handgun. They recovered 9 loaded magazines. They recover a heavy body armor. They recover handcuffs, NYPD uniform items, two axes, a stun gun, multiple knives, a weighted whip, and an expandable baton.
Queens District Attorney Belinda Katz announced Sansone was charged with the following: two counts of criminal possession of a weapon in the second degree, four counts of criminal possession of weapon in the third degree, 10 counts of criminal possession of weapon in the fourth degree, unlawful possession of pistol or revolver ammunition, and unlawful use of police uniform or emblem and issuance number, location, and condition of vehicle plates. If convicted, Sansone may face up to 15 years in prison. Sansone returns to court on June 17.
And just how bully they are, they're bully with other nations. They've done
over in San Francisco, Filipino Americans were joined by members of the Vietnamese, Hong Kong, and Taiwanese communities as they protested in front of the Chinese Consulate General in San Francisco. They held their protest on the June 12th Philippine Independence Day to send a clear message to Beijing. Tensions between the Philippines and China have intensified in recent months amid Beijing's continued aggression in the disputed territories in the West Philippine Sea.
The biggest threat to Philippine independence is China, because China has been encircling the Philippine shoals and the West Philippine Sea. They're taking over one shoal after another.
Activists say they also want China to end the harassment of Philippine vessels and fisher folk in the country's waters.
We're here today to end the occupation from China and end the genocide from China. We're here for human rights, democracy, and freedom.
In the Big Apple, in a stunning display of solidarity with the Philippines in commemoration of its 126th anniversary of independence from Spain, iconic New York landmarks changed the colors of their lights to the colors of the Philippine flag. From dusk till dawn, Niagara Falls turned red, white, blue, and yellow. One World Trade Center illuminated its 414-foot antenna with Philippine colors. Meanwhile, Filipino-American representation was in full display at the state capitol in Albany.
Okay. We celebrate under the theme, Kalayaan, Kinabukasan, Kasaysayan. These three powerful words echo the spirit of the Katipunan, whose bravery and patriotism laid the foundation over a century ago for the freedom we now enjoy.
It's so important that we are spending time with all our elected officials here to see what the priorities are for our community, not just in where we represent. I'm happy to live and represent Little Manila in Woodside, Queens, but throughout the state.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News, and head on over to the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to our friends at the Rundown.